करण सिंह, फॉर्मर राज्यसभा मेंबर ऑनरेबल वाइस चांसलर प्रोफेसर मनोज के धर, श्री गोवर्धन सिंह जम्वाल, चेयरमैन कुंवर वियोगी मेमोरियल ट्रस्ट, मिस्टर आयुष्मान जम्वाल, मेंबर्स ऑफ द ट्रस्ट, लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन, अ वेरी गुड इवनिंग. आई प्रोफेसर सुचेता पठानिया टेक द प्रिविलेज ऑफ वेलकमिंग ऑल टू द ऑनलाइन कुंवर वियोगी मेमोरियल लेक्चर ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ इंग्लिश एंड कुंवर वियोगी मेमोरियल ट्रस्ट. इट इज विद डीप सेंस ऑफ प्राइड एंड प्रिविलेज, मोर सो एज अ डोगरा, दैट आई वेलकम महाराजा डॉक्टर करण सिंह, former Rajya Sabha member, philanthropist and poet. He is a living embodiment of the Dogra history, and it is a rare privilege to hear him speak on the role of Dogra in the Indian history. Sir, I believe that it is a momentous time for the Dogras, and there is a dire need for us to communicate with the rest of the country. Your lecture not only fills such in Indian history, also sets any distortions that have been accepted as historical facts. I heartily welcome you, sir, to share the facts of history with us. I am delighted to accord a warm welcome to Professor Manoj Kedar, Vice Chancellor, University of Jammu. Sir, your commitment to a strong interface between the university and the civil society has taken the university to scale new heights and forge connections that benefit the community that it is a part of. You have always been supportive of initiatives in the Dogri language, including the recently announced a center excellence in Dogri in the university. I welcome you, sir, and your presence today encourages us to keep organizing such collaborative programs for the benefit of students and scholars. I am privileged to welcome Shri Govardhan Singh Jamwal, Chairman Kumar Vyogi Memorial Trust, sir. The trust has grown from strength to strength under your able guidance. We have all witnessed the dynamism and vibrancy that the trust is functioning with and how it is untiringly bringing Jammu and Dogri to the global attention. I welcome you, sir, and hope that the rigor of the trust continues with your blessings. I also accord a warm welcome to Mr. Ayushman Jamwal, Senior Editor, CNN News, who will conduct the question and answer session following the memorial lecture. He has carved a niche for himself, not only in the world of news, but also as a published poet at this young age. He has been actively contributing in the activities of the trust and seems to be following the footsteps of his grandfather, Kumar Vyogi ji, in composing and publishing poetry. I welcome you, Ayushman, to today's event. Before we carry on with the events, I would also like to give my regards and appreciation to all the people who made this occasion a reality. This could not have been possible without the sheer contribution of you all who have overcome all the challenges of the world that functions today in the online mode and created an evening that seems to transgress the distance between us. Finally, I welcome all those who have joined us to listen to the lecture. Since our listeners and our audience is the hallmark of our success, I welcome one and all. It is our holy tradition to worship our goddess Saraswati before any event. So let's dedicate a prayer to Ma Saraswati. For that, I request the organizer to play the Saraswati Vandana. Thank you.
Right. Can we play the Saraswati Vandana?
Who's doing the Saraswati Vandana? Sucheta, where's the Saraswati Vandana? Hello.
Varde varde he ma sharde kalush bhavana man mein जगत कर दे, सकले जगत को सजग कर दे। तिमिर सिंधु हर ले, हे माँ जगमग सकल ये जग कर दे। जगमग सकल ये जग कर दे। पथ आलोकित हो सब जन का, पथ आलोकित हो सब जन का। सत्य मार्ग को ही अपनाए, वर दे वर दे हे माँ शारदे। सतल हो जीवन और आचरण, सकल हो जीवन और आचरण। विद्या का अभिमान न होवे, विद्या का अभिमान न होवे। वर दे वर दे हे माँ शारदे। विद्या बुद्धि का हो समागम, सकल जगत को सजग कर दे। सकले जगत को सजग कर दे। सुर लय ताल के संगम से, सुर लय ताल के संगम से पूरित हो सब का ही जीवन। पूरित हो सब का ही जीवन। वर दे वर दे हे माँ शारदे। कलुष भावना मन में लाए, सकल जगत को सजग कर दे। सकल जगत को सजग कर दे। सकल जगत को सजग कर दे।
Very nice.
We have with us Mr. Ayushman Jamwal, Chief Editor, CNN News, and a young but budding poet. I invite him to further the proceedings of the program. Over to Ayushman.
Thank you, Ms. Kutania, for that very warm welcome. I would like to thank Dr. Karan Singh and Professor Manoj K. Dhar, Vice Chancellor of Jammu University, for joining us on this special occasion where we are trying to elevate the mantle of what it is to be a Dogra by talking about things which are very important to the identity of Dogras. And I think that at the end of the day, now, ever since, we are very much aware about who we are and where we come from. We are very much aware about the ethos that binds us together as a culture, as Dogras and as Indians beyond being Dogras. But I feel that, and this is my experience, and I'm sure other people have experienced this as well, that the DNA of the Dogra is something that we are proud of, but many people in our country are very unaware of. If I go into a newsroom also today, I still remember 9 years back when I first walked into CNN News 18, and they asked me, where do you come from? I said, Jammu and Kashmir. So they said, oh, then you must be Kashmiri. I was like, no, I'm from Jammu, and I'm not Kashmiri in any sense of the term. I am a Dogra. I'm a Dogra Rajput from Jammu and Kashmir. But there was a disconnect over who, what, and where did the Dogras come from to a wider Indian audience? And that is something that I feel that through the Kaur Yogi Memorial Trust is something we're trying to remedy. And the best way to remedy is these kind of things. The best way to elaborate the culture, the rich heritage and the contribution of Dogras is to bring forward the eminent personalities of our country who hail from the Dugar heartland. And I don't think there is anyone bigger in the tapestry of Dogra culture than Dr. Karan Singh, who's joining us today. And who we are so thankful and we're so fortunate to have him with us. He is the living, breathing encyclopedia of Dogra culture. And he is someone whose story is the story of India, if you will, all the way from independence. He has seen it all. And he has seen the transformation of this country. And I think he is someone who has championed the Dogra cause so well. But that story, I think, from his perspective, needs to be told to a wider audience. And the Dogra perspective has to be told. He has been a nationalist through and through. He has championed the cause of a united and a secular India through his entire political career. But we want him to talk about what it is to be a Dogra, what is the ethos of the Dogra culture that has framed the man that he is and framed his thinking of the world and framed the nation at large. Where does the contribution of the Dogras frame into the story of India? And I don't think there's anyone more equipped to tell that story than Dr. Karan Singh, who is joining us. And I'm so thankful that he is agreed to give the second edition of the Kaur Yogi Memorial Trust lecture. But before I get to Dr. Karan Singh, I also want to thank Manoj Kedhar for joining us on this special occasion. And I would like to give him the stage to first give his welcome address before we get to the main lecture. But before that, here's a small look at what the Kaur Yogi Memorial Trust does. Here is a short film of what we aim to do and what we have achieved as a trust, as a cultural force in Jammu so far.
Literature knows no barriers. Language knows no boundaries. The craft of a craftsman is unique. His ability to create a masterpiece is his own. He knows no rules. He makes them. He knows no horizon. He paints it. For he's the one who creates history, and his creation is immortal. Such an artist was born on September 4th, 1940. His contribution to the nation has been as immersive as his contribution to literature.
कुमार विजोगी जो है वो स्वयं एक लेखक ही नहीं थे, उनके अंदर एक विचारधारा चलती थी। उन्होंने जब भी जो भी काम किया बड़े लाइवली ढंग से किया, बड़े जीवंत तरीके से किया और दिल खोल के किया। उनका एक एक बंद जो है वो एक एक महाकाव्य कहता है।
A soldier of the Indian Air Force, Group Captain Randhir Singh took on to writing at a very impressionable age of just 13. With his pseudonym Kuwar Vyogi, this laureate has been crowned as the father of Dogri sonnets and has been awarded by Sahitya Academy.
Jitni sonnet Hindustan mein Kuwar Vyogi ne Dogri mein ya Urdu mein ya Hindi mein likhi hain uska mukabla koi nahi kar sakta. और इतनी ज्यादा लिखी हैं कि ये मुझे लगता है अगर कोशिश की जाए तो ये विश्व रिकॉर्ड बन सकता है।
His masterpiece, Ghar, A Journey of Society and Relationships, ran into 238 verses.
एक टुकड़ा मैं रोटी मंगा सोने की एक नुक्कर एक पल मंगा मुस्काने की इस धरती दे ऊपर पैर एक मंगा रोने की गड़बा एक शराब
With a humble attempt to resuscitate Dogri language, Kuwar Vyogi's contribution is priceless and timeless. Founded in his memory is the Kuwar Vyogi Memorial Trust that endeavors to promote and preserve the history of Dogri language through literature, art, culture, education, and innovation. A platform to give back to the roots what you gained from them. Taking inspiration from Kuvar Vyogi's belief that talent deserves to be nurtured and shared with the world, the Trust offers scholarships in the University of Jammu, Literary Award in association with Dogri Sanstha, and Talent and Innovation Award among other initiatives. Come, join the movement. Let's preserve our heritage. Let's protect our roots. Let's give back to the world the gift of Dogri. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Kuvar Vyogi Memorial Trust.
Awesome. Now I would like to give the floor to Professor Manoj Kedhar to give his opening remarks on the second edition of the Kuvar Vyogi Memorial Trust lecture series. But before, Professor Dhar, before I come to you, if you may indulge me, I wanted to share one couplet from Kuvar Vyogi's Ghar, which was indicative of Jammu, something I've held very close to my heart. This small couplet of four lines is very indicative of Jammu. And Dr. Karan Singh, I beg your forgiveness if my Dogri is not that as strong. So the couplet goes like, Haath jodkar vandan karna gaye jo Jammu nagar. Haath jodkar vandan karna gaye jo Jammu nagar. Sheesh jhukakar uski mitti ka karna aadar. Sheesh jhukakar uski mitti ka karna aadar. Rakt रक्त से इसको सिंचित करते बेटे शेर जवान, रक्त से इसको सिंचित करते बेटे शेर जवान, बेशक बंजर कहलाता है पर वीरों का है घर, बेशक बंजर कहलाता है पर वीरों का है घर. That's the, I think, vision many people when they look at Jammu as the home of heroes. I always say it's the land of warriors, poets, and kings. And I think that those four couplets encapsulate that entire sentiment. Now, before we get to Dr. Karan Singh and he delivers the memorial lecture, the second memorial lecture of the Kuvar Vyogi Memorial Trust, I hand the stage over now to Professor Manoj Kedhar. Thank you for joining us.
Yeah, namaskar and good evening to all of you. Respected Maharaja Dr. Karan Singh Ji, former Member of Parliament, Shri Govardhan Singh Jamwal Saab, KVM, Chairman of the KVM Trust, Mrs. Poonam Jamwal, Mr. Ayushman Jamwal, Professor Sucheta Pathania, Head of the Department English, University of Jammu, distinguished faculty members of University of Jammu, distinguished audience, dear scholars and students. It is indeed a matter of great honor and privilege for me to share the screen with respected Dr. Karan Singh Ji this evening. Also, I am delighted to be in the company of intellectuals, writers, poets, and scholars. Once again, Kuvar Vyogi Memorial Trust is organizing this year's Kuvar Vyogi Memorial Lecture to be delivered by respected Dr. Karan Singh Ji. This event is being organized in collaboration with Department of English, University of Jammu. I must say that there couldn't have been a better person than Dr. Sahib to speak on Dogra history, as he is one such living legend who has himself created the history. While we are eagerly waiting to hear from respected Dr. Karan Singh Ji about the history of Dogras, I am sure all of you will agree that heritage, culture, and language are inherent components of history. It has been proven beyond doubt that knowledge of one's culture, traditions, and language is highly beneficial for the social, educational, and technological advancement. Language is intrinsic to the expression of culture as a means of communicating values, beliefs, and customs. It has an important social function and fosters feelings of group identity and solidarity. It is the means by which culture and its traditions and shared values may be conveyed and preserved. Language is an important part of our lives. It's a unique gift to human beings, which lets us communicate and differentiates us from our ancestors. Language holds the intricate memory and information for thousands of years of a culture. Thus, it may not be wrong to say that culture is encapsulated in our language. Here comes the importance of mother tongue. Learning mother tongue is not just a language for communication. Its tones, nuances, perception of experiences are a reflection and record of a culture, which we get from our parents. One cannot fully appreciate the art in the form of literature, plays, music, film, etc., without knowing the language. Thus, in order to preserve and promote culture, one must preserve and promote a culture's languages. There is no denying the fact that Indian languages are among the richest in the world, having enormous ancient and modern literature, being highly scientific and expressive. We should feel proud to have the legacy of greatest writers and poets in diverse languages, which have deep inside the unfathomable treasure, much of which is yet to be discovered. Let's take an example of Sanskrit. The classical literature of Sanskrit is reported to be much more voluminous than that of Greek and Latin taken together. The Sanskrit literature has volumes and volumes on philosophy, music, architecture, drama, politics, medicine, mathematics, etc. It's a matter of great pride that one such beautiful language called Dogri is the integral part of Dogra heritage. In the recent years, there has been tremendous developments in the Dogri language. Many writers have left indelible imprints on the Dogri literature and brought Dogri language to the limelight. The future of the language is very bright, with a number of enthusiastic writers occupied with work by creating rich content in the form of songs, proverbs, riddles, books, monographs, research papers, etc. I feel happy to share that University of Jammu has the unique distinction of having a full-fledged department of Dogri, and we are in the process of establishing a center of excellence in Dogri in the university. Sir, we would look forward to you for your support and patronage so as to make this center as a hub of activities for the promotion of Dogri and preservation of Dogra culture and heritage. At this point of time, I would like to put on record our sincere gratitude to Kumar Vyogi Trust. I am deeply impressed by the excellent work being done by the Trust for the promotion of Dogri and Dogra cultural heritage by blending the tradition with modernity. The efforts like these are essential in not only preserving our language and culture, but also strengthening cultural identity. Since last several years, the Jammu University is closely working with the Trust, and besides organizing the annual seminars, the Trust is felicitating the student achievers of the university with awards and fellowships. Continuing with these activities, recently, the Trust has come up with a proposal to set up Kumar Vyogi EdTech Hub for Excellence in Languages under the aegis of Jammu University's Center of Excellence in Dogri. I wish to compliment the Trust for such a wonderful initiative, and I'm sure that the EdTech Hub will provide the technological impetus to the development of local languages, particularly Dogri. I'm hopeful that University of Jammu and Kumar Vyogi Trust will together work for the enrichment and promotion of languages, and the proposed EdTech Hub shall provide the required platform to do so. In the National Education Policy 2020, there is tremendous emphasis on promotion of Indian arts and culture, since these are important not only for the nation, but also for the individual. Cultural awareness and expression have been emphasized to be inculcated in present and future generations as major competencies, which can provide them with a sense of identity, belonging, as well as an appreciation of other cultures and identities. With a strong sense and knowledge of our culture, history, arts, languages, and traditions, we can together build a peaceful world. We are a young nation. As the fastest growing economy today, 1/5 of the world's youth live in India. Half of our population of 1.3 billion is below the age of 25, and a quarter is below the age of 14. India's young population is its most valuable asset and most pressing challenge. It provides India with a unique demographic advantage. We can set example for the world because our country has always been peace-loving, and the greatest apostle of world peace and non-violence, Mahatma Gandhi, was born in India. I would like to quote Cy Miller and Jill Jackson, "Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me." Being an educational institution, University of Jammu, it's our endeavor to develop and hone the intellectual, moral, social, and physical capacities of our youth so as to transform them into rational, compassionate, and well-rounded individuals and make this planet a better place to live and let live. I would also like to congratulate Colonel Ranveer Singh Jamwal, VSM, for getting the Kumar Vyogi Shaurya Award. I would like at the end to convey sincere thanks to Kumar Vyogi Trust for making University Jammu a part of this endeavor and also for inviting me to this function. Jai Hind. Namaskar.
Jai Hind. Thank you, Professor Dhar, for that insightful take on education and the need for the youth to be part of such social endeavors. I absolutely agree with you that the youth are the greatest asset, but they're the greatest challenge as well, how to harness their potential for any social endeavor. Now over to the main event of the evening, which is the Kumar Vyogi Memorial Trust lecture. Now, before I before I give the floor to Dr. Karan Singh to tell us about the role of Dogras in Indian history, I found something very interesting that among Kumar Vyogi sonnets, second volume of the Rosary of Sonnets, there's actually a couplet on Dr. Karan Singh itself. It's couplet number 300 in the Rosary of Sonnets by Kumar Vyogi on Dr. Karan Singh. And I believe in the spirit of Kumar Vyogi, that would be the best introduction for Dr. Karan Singh. And the couplet goes something like this. It goes, "Scion of a brave and prideful clan, which starting from the ragged and arid region of Jammu, gathered through its brawn and brain, irrespective of the color or religion, along with verdant valley of Kashmir, Ladakh, and Gilgit in its fold. You really proved to be a pioneer, a truly cast in your ancestral mold, an artist and a lover of arts who understands the condense of time, a man of many talents, many parts, a man for every season, every clime, who changes with the times but retains the beauty of the past without chains." That was written for you, Dr. Karan Singh, by Kumar Vyogi in his second volume of Rosary of Sonnets. And like I said, and like Professor Dhar has also said, there is no one better than you who can explain to us, who can explain to the world at large about the contribution of and the spirit of the Dogras when it comes to shaping the idea of India. And on that note, I give the floor to you to present the second Kumar Vyogi Memorial Trust lecture, The Role of Dogras in Indian History. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Ayushman. And thank you, Professor Dhar, for your very, very illuminating remarks, particularly on language. I'm so happy that the Jammu University is now taking Dogri seriously, because this is something I've been working on for many decades. And if you have a center of excellence in Dogri, I think that will be a very good undertaking. My good wishes will be certainly with you on that. And please let me know how things develop. Kamal Govardhan Singh Jamwal, who is the chairman of this Kumar Vyogi Memorial Trust, young Ayushman, Professor Sweta, I was going to say Kripalani, not Kripalani, Patania, and all those who are watching, visible and invisible. Let me at the outset pay a tribute to late group captain Randhir Singh, whose pen name was Kumar Vyogi. He has really had an extraordinary output of Dogri poetry, and I pay my tribute to him. I did not meet him, I don't think, personally. He may have met me, but I know the family very well indeed. We've been very closely associated. And their mission, the revival, preservation, and promotion of the Dogri language through education, art, and innovation is an excellent mission. I'm so glad they're moving ahead to try and do this. Let me recall that it was with great difficulty that we got Dogri included in the 8th schedule of our constitution. We had to go through several decades of agitations and representations. And I remember my debate in the Raj Sabha when Advani ji then was Home Minister. And ultimately, we succeeded in getting Dogri was not originally in the 8th schedule, but we fought with it with all our strength. In fact, that is the very first time that I ever actually sat on dharna myself, believe it or not. But I said, look, I can't sit on the floor. I need a chair to sit on dharna. In any case, we finally got this thing, and now, Professor Dutt, it is in your hands to do what needs to be done for the development of Dogri. Now, the topic that is given to me is the role of Dogra in the history of India. See, India is the most remarkable country. It has such a diversity of languages, of cultures. Despite an underlying unity, there are dozens of different ethnicities, shall we say. And these, all the way from Ladakh down to Tamil Nadu, from Leh down to Kanyakumari, we have so many different languages. Now, after the state's reorganization in 1956, there was a linguistic states. And the linguistic states meant that more or less each ethnic entity had its own state, whether it was the Gujaratis or the Bengalis or the Tamils or the Telugus or the Malayalis, or you name them, they had their own separate states. The only exception are the Dogras, who have only half a union territory. Far from having a state, we have half a union territory. I'm just putting that on record, because one of the reasons why the Dogras have never received their due share is because we never had a state that would actually further the interests of the Dogras. The Dogras was always a sort of an attachment to Kashmir, as it were, although it had its own distinct entity and distinct culture and language and culture, it was tagged on. And we are still now, as I said, only half a union territory. But that aside, I thought I'd put that on record before we go on to the history, that is contemporary history. Now, when you talk of history, you can go back into the mists of the past. They say that there was mention in the Mahabharata, not with the word Dogra, but with the rulers of this area. There were mentions of Bador, and there are ancient ruins in Kirinchi, in Ambara, in various places in Jammu, which show that the civilization was very old. In fact, there are some Buddhist remains in Ambara, which again put the history back many thousands of years when there was the Buddhist domination of that area. So we go back very far in ancient history. But I think we should talk about Dogras in modern history. And in modern history, there is no doubt that the Dogra history really began with three remarkable young men who left a village in Jammu and went all the way to Lahore to the Sikh Darbar. Gulab Singh, Dhyan Singh, and Sujit Singh. These three brothers, Jamwal brothers, went. They joined. Gulab Singh joined as a soldier, but by sheer dint of their capacity, their loyalty, their bravery, they rose rapidly in the ranks of Sher-e Punjab Maharaja Ranjit Singh, his army. And Gulab Singh, of course, became a general, one of his most trusted generals, who was always with him whenever he was fighting his wars, whether they were in Kabul or elsewhere. And the Sikh Empire, as you know, at that time was a huge empire. Not only Punjab as we know it now, it covered all of East Punjab and West Punjab, of course, and Kangra, and it covered a lot of the northwest frontier and north. So the Sikh Empire built up by the great Maharaja Ranjit Singh, the Dogras played a very important role in that. All the three brothers. Dhyan Singh was also at one time chief minister, Sujit Singh. And they gave a lot of sacrifices there. Maharaja Gulab Singh lost his brother, he lost his two sons, He had three sons, he lost two of his sons with the intrigues in the Sikh court. So remember that despite all of that, he remained loyal entirely to Maharaja Ranjit Singh. But when Maharaja Ranjit Singh passed away and the Sikh missiles started fighting with each other, Gulab Singh realized, I must tell you before that, 200 years ago, exactly almost, in 1822, Maharaja Ranjit Singh with his own hand gave a Raj Tilak to Gulab Singh, made him Raja of Jammu. It's very interesting. He gave the Raj Tilak like this, up down. And the Pandit said, Nini, you should give from down. He said, no, I want that his family should be firmly rooted in the ground. And look, unki apni family, his own family has disappeared, but by his blessings and by the grace of the divine, our family continues in full force. So that was 1822 when he became Raja. And it was after that that the Dogra forces started expanding. They started expanding in a most extraordinary manner with these trans-Himalayan battles. Mind you, the conquest of Ladakh and of Gilgit did not come without fierce battles. It wasn't that we just walked into an empty territory. There were local Rajas there and they strongly resisted. But we had the amount of sacrifice that the Dogras had made in expanding the frontiers of India has never been truly recognized. We must have lost thousands of young men in these battles for Ladakh and for Gilgit. General Zorawar Singh, the iconic General Zorawar Singh, General Baz Singh, Mehta Basti Ram, these are the great generals of Maharaja Gulab Singh. And that is how we brought the frontiers of India, extended them all the way up to Central Asia in Gilgit and up to Tibet in Ladakh. This is a remarkable thing, I must tell you. They were great. I mean, we've had great rulers, great heroes. Maharana Pratap battled valiantly. And Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj also did the most extraordinary things. But always remember, they did fight, they're fighting within India. It is only the Dogras, Sikhs first in Kabul, but it was only the Dogras who really extended the territories of India. Otherwise, I make bold to say that if it had not been for the Dogras, our northern frontiers would have finished at the Peer Panjal Range. The fact that we were able to consolidate the territories and the creation of the Jammu and Kashmir state in 1846 with the Treaty of Amritsar was a very major event in modern Indian history. Because for the first time, it consolidated all these disparate areas, the Baltis, the Ladakhis, the Dogras, the Kashmiris, the Punjabi, but all into one state. And that state was the state of Jammu and Kashmir, founded in 1846, of which the first Maharaja was Maharaja Gulab Singh. So the creation of the state of Jammu and Kashmir was a very major achievement in modern Indian history. And it is not adequately recognized that this creation came with tremendous sacrifices from the youth of Himachal Pradesh and Jammu, the Dogra belt. General Zorawar Singh himself was from Himachal. the youth, Govinda youth, gave ultimate sacrifices in order that this state should be built. And that was a great achievement of Maharaja Gulab Singh. And after that, of course, we've had, technically, there have been 5 Maharajas in the J&K state. There was Maharaja Ranbir Singh, who was a great, he consolidated what Maharaja Ranbir Singh had conquered, Maharaja Gulab Singh had conquered. He consolidated that. Hunza, Nagar, and these outer areas were also integrated into the Kashmir Darbar. And Maharaja Ranbir Singh was a great visionary, great temple builder. The great temples you see in Jammu, the Raghunath temple, the Ranbireshwar temple, dozens of temples were built by him in the Jammu region. He was a scholar. He had sent his pandits out to collect manuscripts from around the country. We have 7,000 manuscripts in the research library in Jammu. So he was the second ruler, Maharaja Ranbir Singh. Then there was Maharaja Pratap Singh, who ruled for 40 years, whose reign was marred by quite a lot of intrigues and all. At one stage he was deposed and then he came back into power again. But he was a very saintly person. And it was during his time that a lot of the things done by his, for example, the Ranbir Penal Code, which Maharaja Ranbir Singh had introduced, was then clarified in the reign of Maharaja Pratap Singh. A lot of new canals were built and a lot of developments take place. He was the third. The fourth Maharaja, of course, was my father, Maharaja Hari Singh, who was really the modernizer of the state of Jammu and Kashmir. He came to the Gaddi in 1925. And the first thing that he said is, as a Maharaja, I have no religion. My religion is justice. I think that's an extraordinary thing to have said at that time and place. Is it not, Professor Thar? What a remarkable thing to say. And he got rid of Begad, which is that forced labor, the abominable system. He threw all temples in J&K open to the Harijans, as they were then called, or the Dalits, as they are now called, in 1929. Long before the rest of India, he threw the temples open. I remember Pandit Devraj was the Raj Pandit. He didn't agree. He dismissed Pandit Devraj. And he called his brother Pandit Balakrishnan. Agar aap mante ho to theek hai, otherwise I'll dismiss you also. I agree. So he did that in 1929. And he was the one who built beautiful colleges which are still there in Srinagar and in Jammu, the excellent hospitals and all the other modernizations that took place. It is a great pity that he is only remembered because of the debacle in 1947. But we must remember his achievements before that, from 1925 to 1946, all the work that he did for the consolidation of Jammu and Kashmir. And then, of course, I'm the fifth Maharaja, because I was also Maharaja from 1961 to 1968 when the princes were abolished. But I never used the title. That's why, Mr. Chetaji, you must never call me Maharaja. Because when I became Maharaja, I made a public declaration I was not going to use the title. As it turned out, the titles were abolished a few years later. That was a different thing. I'm always ahead of my time, remember that. Whatever I've tried to do has been to see the future, a leap into the future. And Bapuji, of course, he signed the Instrument of Accession in 1940. I'm not going to go into that whole history of how 1947 happened and how the raiders came in, led by Pakistani military officers in plain clothes, and how they were coming towards Srinagar, how my father called the Chief of Army Staff, Brigadier Rajendra Singh. And I was in the room when he called him. He said, Rajendra, you've got to fight till the last man and the last bullet. He said, Your Highness, I will do it. He saluted him, he saluted me, and he walked out of the room. He held the raiders up for 2 days in Udi. And they were crucial days. Because had we not got those 2 days, perhaps the raiders would have reached the airport and that would have been the end. Because if the airport had fallen, then there was no way the Indian army could come in. In any case, that was a very, very tense and a very difficult period. But my father signed the instrument of accession in Jammu Harinivas, 1947, 26th of October. I was in the house, I was not in the room, I was in the same house at that time. And of course, then the rest is history. My own role, if I may say so, I can't talk about myself, but my own role was really to spearhead the transition from feudalism to democracy. Because feudalism had disappeared at that time. I realized immediately that the future did not lay in feudalism, it lay in strengthening the democratic fabric of India. And that's what I, in my own way, have tried to do ever since I was 18 years old, when my father made me regent. And then how the whole situation changed, I became Sadr-e Riyasat, and then governor, and then cabinet minister, and so on. So I don't know why people keep calling me former Rajya Sabha member. I mean, I was a member of both houses, for God's sake. And I was former cabinet minister, former ambassador. So I hate this former word. It's looking backwards. You just mention what I am, what I am doing for the future. So anyhow, that's what I want to say about the history of the Dogras. But the Dogri language itself, of course, and the Dogri culture is something which is very permanent and very important. I remember my father used to speak beautiful Dogri. I speak very nice Dogri. My sons speak very good Dogri, but the grandsons don't, unfortunately. And this is happening all over India now. One generation is keeping the mother tongue, the second one goes, the third one disappears. It's happening to all of you also, I'm sure. To the Kashmiris, to the Telugus, to the Bengalis, it's happening to everybody, it's happening to us also. But let me talk about some aspects of Dogri culture. We talk first about literature. Dogri, I remember I was part of the renaissance of the Dogri language, which took place in the 1940s. That began with people like Dinu Bhai Pant and Ramna Shastri and Samal Puri. Those were the first people who started writing in Dogri. I remember the first poem was Shair Palo Palge by Dinu Bhai Pant. But anyhow, there were many other people came in. The Dogri Sansa was founded. I was there when it was founded. I've given them some land in my area where they're still building 60 years onwards. But nonetheless, they say that they're building. I'll only believe it when I see the building, because you know they haven't invited me to the building yet. But whenever they do, I'll be very happy to see it. But the Dogri movement took root, and a lot of very brilliant poets came up. We've talked of Kumar Vyogi. We had Padma Sachdev, the poetess who wrote such wonderful poetry. We had Madhukar, K. Singh Madhukar, Dorla Kona Thappeya, a great poem. You know, there are these great young people, a lot of new young people have come up. I'm not fully aware of the younger generation, but Dogri language and literature has come up. And that's why we insisted that Dogri should become a national language. I must mention one small point in passing. There was some talk at one time of trying to revive Takri, which was a script. I opposed it. I said, if you really want Dogri to be understood, you have to put it in Devanagari. Of all of Ghalib that we learned was in Devanagari, for God's sake. We didn't have to learn. You can't learn a language in order to read it. So the Takri script was all right at its time. It showed that we had a certain capacity, but I have supported the Dogri literature should be in Devanagari so that it's available to a wider audience. So that's as far as Dogri is concerned. My good wishes to all of you who are working in the field of Dogri, particularly to Professor Dhar and his center in Jammu University. Then art. We were not only fighters, we were also people of great artistic sensibilities. The Pahadi schools of art, for example, the schools in Basoli, Kangra. I mean, the Kangra paintings are the most beautiful miniatures in the world. Wherever I go in the world, I visited all the great museums around the world. And wherever I've been, there's been a Kangra painting there. Every, whether it's the Prada in Spain, or the Hermitage in Leningrad, or whether it is the Albert and Victor and Albert Museum in London, or the modern, or the museum in New York, all of them. So the Kangra Kalam and the Basoli Kalam, these are two very important schools of Pahari painting in the Dogra area. And I'd like to tell you that the Haritara Charitable Trust that I have created, my daughter Josna, has started a school of Basoli painting in Basoli. So one of the masters, living masters of Basoli painting, is teaching youngsters how to develop this particular school. We're trying to keep that alive. So in art, a great deal has been done. There are lots of books on Pahari painting. I don't have to go into that. Architecture. Apart from the ancient architecture, the ruins that I mentioned, the architecture, the way this Raghunath temple, for example, has been built. I don't think anywhere else in the world is there a temple which has one sub-temple dedicated to almost every deity in the Hindu pantheon. If you go around the Parikrama, you can have darshan of almost all the devas. It's extraordinary temple. And then the outer, which are the great Shiva temples, where I have also made additions in two rooms. I've made a new Nataraj Bagalamukhi temple in that outer line. So the Raghunath temple, each successive ruler made his own contribution, the architecture. The Ranveereshwar temple, this extraordinary Shiva temple, which Maharaja Ranveer Singh built in Jammu. It's a wonder of architecture. It's built in the form of a yantra, on a yantra, and it is something which I think is quite remarkable. So, and then the group of palaces known as Mandi Mubarak. It's a cluster of many palaces built from time to time. Perhaps it's the largest cluster of palaces anywhere in the world. It's not a single palace like the huge palaces in Rajasthan. It's a whole cluster of palaces. And now at last, I think something is being done about trying to preserve it, because obviously it was many of the buildings were on the verge of collapse. So architecture also we've excelled. Then I must talk about cuisine. The Dogra food is so delicious, it makes my mouth water. I don't want to mention the ambals and the mahanis and all the delicious things that are made in Kangra. My mother was from Kangra. And between her and my father, it made the most delicious Dogra dishes. And then, of course, one fact that the Dogras have been very inclusive. Mind you, the word Dogra doesn't only mean Dogra Rajputs. There are Dogra Dalits, there are Dogra Brahmins, there are Dogra Khatris, there are Dogra Muslims. The great Ustad Allah Rakha Khan, the Dogra Master, he was from Jammu. Uchcha Pind Sakarunga. And the son now, Zakir Hussain, who is probably the greatest percussionist we've ever produced, is from Jammu. Shiv Kumar Sharma, the extraordinary santur player who has introduced a new instrument into Hindustani music, is from Jammu. So Jammu has produced great musicians, and cutting across barriers of caste and creed and language. We've always been secular, although I don't like the use of that term, but we've been secular in the sense that we've been inclusive. And in my father's army, there were not only Dogra Rajputs, there were Dogra Brahmins, there were Sikhs, there were Gorkhas, and there were Muslims from the Punch Rajouri area. So this is something I think we need to be kept in mind. And finally, I go back to the tradition of valor and bravery. From Brigadier Rajinder Singh onwards down, I was responsible for the entire Jammu and Kashmir state forces being integrated into the Indian Army as a separate regiment. None of the other state forces were able to do that. They were all broken up, went to the Rajput regiment, the Sikh regiment, the Jat regiment, and so on. It was only JNK regiment, thanks to me, if I may say so, that with my strong intervention with Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, he agreed that the JNK state forces, General Gwardar Singh is still there, our retired general. He must be listening to this. Now, he's 93 now, 3 years older than I am. Only 3 years older than I am. Not all that old. But it was integrated en masse into the Indian. And today, it is proud as the Jack Rifles. The Jack Rifles are the former army of Maharaja Gulab Singh coming down from that time. The names are still there of the various units. Then there's a Dogra regiment, which is also very is from the Dogra areas, whether from Jammu or from Himachal Pradesh. And then there are Dogras in many other areas. So I think between all of this, between the architecture, the art, the literature, the cuisine, and the inclusiveness and the valor of the Dogras, I think we can be very proud of our contribution to Indian history. We can, I mean, we may not be as well known, which is unfortunate. In fact, I hope that the textbooks that now are new textbooks that are being made record the fact of what the Dogras did for the extension and consolidation of the northern boundaries of India. Something which has never been fully acknowledged. We've had about a lot of negative historicity by Sikh historians and the British historians. But now we are beginning to revive the Dogra history, not in order to distort it, but in order to present it in its correct light. And I have this Maharaja Gulab Singh Memorial Research Institute in Jammu, which is working with your university also. In fact, the main people there, Professor Pal, and are from the university. We are trying to have seminars to revisit Dogra history, to try and see what were the great achievements that we did, and try and place this whole Dogra history in the broader context of Indian history. So with these words, what I would like to again pay tribute to Komal Vyogi, in whose name this lecture is, and to compliment Govardhan and Ayushman and his younger brother Anuj for what they're doing. More strength to their elbows. It's good to see young people coming up. I mean, age is only a number, mind you. I was 90 on my last birthday. That doesn't mean I'm old. There's a very good saying: you don't become old. When you stop growing, you become old. When you become old, when you stop growing. So if you stop growing, you become old, you become ossified. But if you continue to grow intellectually, spiritually, then you can remain as long as Lord Shiva wants you to be here. So with those words, thank you very much, all of you. Thank you, Professor Dhar. Thank you, Sujeta. Thank you, Govardhan. Thank you, Ayushman. And good luck to all of you. I'm now ready to answer any question that you may like to ask.
So, yes, sir. If you may indulge me, I had a couple of questions after your illuminating lecture. And when you talk about age, I still remember I was 15 years old in Dune School, Dehradun, when you were the chief guest. And I took one quote of yours to heart where, live life that no one says that youth is wasted on the young. So that should be the mission.
Bernard Shaw.
Bernard Shaw, yeah. And I think you emphasize the ethos of that saying almost every day.
Bernard Shaw said, youth is a wonderful thing. What a pity it is wasted on the young. The young very often don't appreciate.
Absolutely. I mean, when we are young, we take a lot of things for granted. Only when we get older do many of us realize what we could have done. But you, even at the age of 90, are still with all the vigor and zest of life, keeping the cause.
Shiva's grace. Om Namah Shivaya.
Om Namah Shivaya.
Om Namah Shivaya.
The question I had, I think one of the most interesting things I think which came out in your lecture was the transition from feudalism to democracy, as you said, was the future of Jammu and Kashmir, something that was identified by not just you, but even your father, Maharaja, Hari Singh. And on that note, and you also said that Maharaja Hari Singh introduced many measures which laid the foundation, if you will, for democracy to take root by empowering the downtrodden and the common man in general in Jammu and Kashmir. What did it take for him to break from those generations of tradition to instill that notion of democracy into an empire that has been ruled by feudalism for generations?
Yes, well, it must have been difficult for him, I must say. Because actually, I did the break. But he did, as you said, the foundations for this, by the way that he had me educated and by the way that he did all these reforms. He was quite clearly not hanging on to an old feudal system. But the actual break must have been painful for him. Mm. Much more painful for him than for me. Because for me, it was an exciting adventure, getting into the broader national mainstream. For him, it was giving up just several generations of power. But he took it very bravely, I must say. He never complained. And even though he was more or less sent into exile, he never said a word. One sentence by him could have really put India in a very, very difficult position, because the whole matter was then still before the Security Council. But he was, as a great patriot that he was, despite the fact that he felt that he was not properly treated by the government of India, he never once complained. And that has got to go to his eternal credit.
Right.
Point not really made, but something to understand.
Absolutely, sir. So nowadays, if we look at the media narratives that are around Jammu and Kashmir, and being in the media, they're very standard narratives when it comes to J&K. Primarily, even before and even after the abrogation of Article 370, the common narrative is Hindu-dominated Jammu and Muslim-dominated Kashmir.
Mm.
And primarily the fact, and even beyond that, to an extent, Jammu is not even recognized in the common mindset of people. Jammu is not even recognized as a dominant or as a significant region of Kashmir. Pretty much it's considered that it's a Muslim-dominated state without any other culture or region playing a major role in the makeup of that entire state. Now, you pointed out something very significant, which I think something many people need to know, that the word Dogra doesn't really mean Dogra Rajput. It means Dogra Sikh, Dogra Muslim. You could be of any caste, creed, and religion. You are a Dogra at the end of the day. And you highlighted all those eminent people of different faiths who are from the Dogra community themselves. Why do you think that nature of identity of the Dogras has transformed into this very simplistic narrative that we tend to live with on a daily basis when it comes to the news that we get from Jammu and Kashmir?
Well, you know, it is true that 80% of the former state of Jammu and Kashmir was Muslim. And it is remarkable that the Dogras, who were a Hindu dynasty, ruled for 100 years. And there was not any very great tension. I mean, Sheikh Abdullah, I don't want to go into that. He raked up a lot of anti-Dogra feeling. But generally, this was the situation. Now the thing has changed because a considerable part of the Muslim Jammu and Kashmir was even what is there, POJK, the Muzaffarabad Mirpur strip, that has gone there. But still there is this feeling that, and then what has happened, the tragedy of the eviction of the Kashmiri Pandits from the valley. That is something really very, very painful. I mean, all the shiksha that I have got in my life are from Kashmiri Pandits. I owe them an ineradicable debt of gratitude. But the way that they all had to en masse leave, and that sort of, so from what 95% has become 99.9% Muslim, that's Kashmir. But Jammu retained, Jammu never had this sort of pogrom or any sort of evacuation. Apart from what happened in the partition, that is a different matter. But once the partition took place and the state was consolidated, after that there was never any such problem. So I think it's important that Jammu should be recognized. It is, people say, it is the state of Jammu and Kashmir which we founded. It is not the state of Kashmir. Of course, Kashmir has its own entity, there's no doubt about it. It has its own culture, it has its own literature, it has its own philosophy. People like Acharya Abhinav Gupta, who are among the greatest philosophers in the world. It has its Raj Sarangani and so on. Kashmir has its own culture and language. Nobody denies that. But Jammu is totally different. It's a different language, it's a different culture, it's a different cuisine, it's a different dress. I mean, we have our own identity. So therefore, to overlook the Jammu identity, or to in some strange way mingle it with, as a minority say, that's not the way to look at it. It is Jammu and Kashmir, two distinct entities brought together by my family.
Yes, absolutely, sir. So also, I wanted to ask you, like, you also brought up the contribution of General Zorawar Singh, you brought up the contribution of Maharaja Gulab Singh, not only as statesmen, but also as generals who did a great deal in not only expanding, like you said, the frontiers of the of India, but also defending the frontiers of India, and also inculcating the notion of Dogra culture into the whole idea of India. Now, to a great extent, like you also pointed out, historians, be it the British historians, be it the many Sikh historians also, as you pointed out, there has been a kind of a pushing them to the sidelines of history. Even if we look at modern history, Brigadier Rajendra Singh, the first Mahavir Chakra recipient of independent India, he is not known beyond the Jammu region. So what is the nature of politics where such people who are so integral in the formation of a country, of an idea of a country, that they get pushed to the sidelines? What is the nature of politics that tends to do that? And what was the end game of that politics to push them to the sidelines like this?
This again brings me to what I said right at the beginning. Mm-hmm. The Dogras are the only ethnic community without a state of their own. Mm-hmm. You know, how is it that the Andhra government pushes Telugu language? That the Tamil Nadu government pushes Tamil at every possible opportunity? That the Bengalis have that? We have no state. We have half a union territory. Some of us individually, if you read the book that Harbant Singh has written, Karan Singh 1947 to 1949 to 1964, you can see all that I did in my correspondence with Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, constantly bringing up the points of Jammu. Hmm. Nobody ever brought them up before that. I was the first to do it on a public stage. And I was also the first person from Jammu to represent Jammu from the Udhampur constituency in the Lok Sabha. 4 times I won from Udhampur constituency in the Lok Sabha. And so the reason is that we've never had a Dogra chief minister except Ghulam Nabi Azad. He was from Jammu. And I must say his 2.5 years as chief minister is still remembered both in Jammu and in Kashmir, very positive. But apart from Ghulam Nabi Azad, all the chief ministers have been Kashmiris. I mean, fair enough, the Kashmiris were a majority, so they got the chief minister, but we never had political leadership of that type. And if I may say so also, in a vein of slight criticism, the Dogras also tend to be very, very, what should I say, disunited. You know, they're so individualistic that they don't want anybody to emerge. You know, that sort of thing. And therefore, we never are able to get together, even to the present day. But that's a different matter. That's something which maybe is in our DNA also. But one of the reasons is the lack of political leadership. Now, with the Union Territory, I've talked to the Lieutenant Governor. I think now there's an awareness that of the importance of Jammu. Kashmir is still perhaps the main focus, but now the importance of Jammu is being increasingly recognized.
Right. So my final question to you, is that you are someone who is, like you have said, and like we all know, you have been at the helm of this cause to propagate Dogra culture, Dogra identity, and also the basic rights that the Dogra community has demanded from the center, given the contributions of the Dogras to shaping the idea of India. Now, to a great extent, a lot of people from Jammu have gone to other parts of the world, other parts of the country. We're doing well for ourselves. We're in professional careers, we're in social service, many different things. Now what brings us together is the fact that we're all Dogras and we're fighting to kind of like promote our culture. Today's youth are very active on social media, especially in my opinion, the youth of Jammu and Kashmir, even if they don't have a voice in the mainstream, they are a force on social media. You look at Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, they are a force on social media. They tend to push a lot of the unknown narratives about Dogra culture on social media. So there is that platform that is being recognized by not just politicians, even news media outlets. It's shaping the narrative of how we do political discourse in this day and age. Now, as someone who has led the cause for so many years, what would be your message to just the common Dogras who are set up across this country from Jammu to even who are set up even in the West, who all they want to do is serve the Dogra identity in some way or the other? What would be your message to them as someone who has led the charge for so many years?
Well, as you say, the Dogras are now doing well around the country and abroad. There's an international Dogra association in London with whom I've interacted. There's the other one led by Manu Khajuria. I can't remember the name of the organization. So there are many people around the world. The big thing I think is for Dogras to keep their identity, not to lose their identity. They can fit in wherever they have to do, because we are Indians basically. As Indians, then we are Dogras. We are not Dogras if we are not Indians, because it's part of the Indian the culture of India, as I said. But if we keep on to our identity, if possible, if we maintain our language, which is gradually beginning to disappear with each generation, and if we are able to have some organization together, Dogri Sanstha, or various other organizations in Jammu, or yours, the Common Yogi Trust. I mean, these are the sort of organizations that will bring together the Dogras from around the world. I am a pre-computer generation. I have no idea of Twitter and how you use these newfangled social media thing, but you are the young people, you should do that. I love appearing on shows like this, and then you can put me on Twitter. I don't go on Twitter automatically. I'm one step removed from the social media, but thanks to people like you, and I've done a lot of webinars recently, I must tell you. Since COVID began, I must have done 20, 25 webinars on philosophy, on education, whatever. So this is the way that I can communicate to the rest of the Dogra community. And through you, I send my very warm greetings to the Dogras around India and around the world, and wish them well in the years and decades ahead.
Right. Thank you so much, sir. And with that, thank you so much for your thoughts, your kind of your wisdom when it comes to taking this cause ahead. Of course, this is something we should all imbibe, and we should all kind of like carry in our hearts when it comes to championing the cause of who we are and where we come from. And we just hope that even at the age of 30, where I'm at 32 right now, that I have even 50% of the energy you have at the age of 90. So I hope that we can carry that energy forward. And as Dogras and as Indians in general, we can understand what the Dogra community has brought to the ethos of India and bring it to the mainstream. And your blessing and your guidance is enough kind of like power and zest that we need to kind of like take that message forward. Now, before we leave, if you may just indulge me, sir, I would like to announce the Shaurya Award, which is going to Colonel Ranveer Singh Jamwal. We've got a short film on Colonel Ranveer Singh Jamwal. He's an avid mountaineer. He's someone who has done great service to the Dogra cause in the armed forces. I'd like to play a short movie of his, and then he sent us a message from the front positions that from where he is serving. we have a message from Colonel Ranbir Singh Kamal as well? You can play that as well. He especially sent this message to us, thanking us for.
I want to thank the Kumar Vyogi Memorial Trust for honoring me with the Shaurya Kala Samman and recognizing my contributions as a soldier, an adventurer, and a Dogra. I promise that I will keep up the traditions and ethics and will keep the flag flying high. Thank you so much.
Right. So short message, a man in service. He's obviously short of time. So, but he's obviously always keeping the Dogra flag flying high, and we're honoring him for his service. Now, before we close the proceedings, I want to hand it over to the chairman of the KVM Trust, Govardhan Singh Jamwal, to give us the closing remarks. I think you have to unmute.
Thank you, Ayushman. First of all, I would like to express my sincere gratitude and many, many thanks to Maharaja Sahab. Sorry, sir, but I would like to address you in this way only. In this way, I'm slightly old-fashioned, and I hope you won't mind it. And about enlightening us about the role of Dogras in Indian history, the topic of our annual lecture series in memory of Kumar Vyogi. Needless to say, it's always an exhilarating experience for me to listen to you on any topic, be it about J&K history, be it about education, be it about spirituality. And I'm proud that the great contribution of Dogras in Indian history, both pre-independence and post-independence. So thank you so much, sir, for sparing your valuable time for this lecture for the trust. Thank you so much. Yeah. I would also like to thank our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Manoj Dharji. Sir, it's a great pleasure to have you in our events almost for the last 4 years. You've been a real guide and a real great sutradhar, facilitator in whatever this trust ever initiated and wanted to complete that task in the promotion of Dogri language or Dogri culture or anything connected with Jammu. So thank you so much for your constant kind of help and constant kindness. And I'm thinking that I'll look forward to seeing you in person very soon in Jammu. All these 2 years, because of the COVID, we have not been able to meet. Otherwise, we always love to have you around in the campus whenever we organize these programs. But thank you so much for all your cooperation till date, sir. Would like to congratulate Dr. Pathania on her assuming the role of head of English department. Ma'am, I look forward in interacting with you very soon and discuss very initiatives that we can start in promoting Dogri and English language, not only in J&K, but outside J&K and around the world. So there are a few ideas, but we are putting it in a very chronological order and discuss with you and take it from there. So thank you so much for participation today. And finally, congratulations to Colonel Ranveer Singh Jamwal, the recipient of Shaurya Award for this year. Colonel Jamwal, you are a real inspiration, not only to the people of J&K, but to the all the people of India. He is a living example of our brave hearts safeguarding our borders in the most challenging and in very inhospitable kind of environment in the world. and ensuring that the rest of India sleeps in peace. So all power to you, Colonel Jamwal, and may God bless you and your family and your fraternity. With this, thank you so much, everyone, and good night. Thank you.
Right. Thank you, Govardhan Singh Jamwal, KVM Trust Chairman, for your closing remarks. Dr. Karan Singh, sir, thank you very much for that inspiring and very candid lecture about Dogra culture and the role of Dogras in Indian history. And even going beyond that, talking about where we stand as a culture today and what power we have, the untapped power we have to kind of like elevate us into the mainstream and how it all rests within us. And your example is something we all can aspire towards. I want to thank Honorable Vice Chancellor of Jammu University, Professor Dhar, for his vision and constant encouragement to the trust. Also, Ms. Pathania, thank you for hosting the second edition of the lecture series. Thank you so much. And you're always an encouraging force whenever it comes to any of our operations. Thank you so much for joining us. And before I leave, here is an ode to Dogri in Kuvar Vyogi Memorial, in Kuvar Vyogi's words himself. It's a very special poem that he has written, and it has been sung by two very fine artists, Ruhi and Juhi. Listen in.
Gama pa gama re sa re ni pa ni sa ga re pa re ga ga re sa pa sa re sa pa re ga re sa. Gama pa gama re sa re ni pa ni sa ga re pa re ga ga re sa pa sa re sa pa re ga re sa. E poli e meram meri usar ti muskaan ti dukhi jugadi andhi ki e aase ne takraan ti. Narmada baate da manu sochi sochi turda dil jalda par uf nahi karda bicho bichi kurda poli meri pehn nikki chanchal ta di rani sach puchho ta asdi asdi mittar ta mastani pulle pulle pere kanne aai sarene bondi nikke nikke athe kanne daag dukhe de tondi so so khad chadu ke kariye man mera par chandi ikle beye jiya apni gutti ke patiyan di kol machate beye piyo khabre ke likh di chori chori nazar charaiye ki mere al dikh di
tus papa ji roye hoye di
tus papa ji roye hoye di aao sakul janni अपनाओ सबक सनांदी भर के पन्नी पन्नी पी के मादा नुस्खा ले गलों परी पुछदी
कैसी तुस कुंदे नहीं दसो आऊं जरा नहीं रुसदी
ए वे दिल दी अमर निशानी ए वे दिल दी अमर निशानी इन्नी सेवा कर दी मेरे खोरे बोलेगी ये मन मारी बेचर दी किया आखा खोई नहीं सकदे
इरखी बोल जबानी
सीने दे बिच हिरदे जलदा नैने अंदर पानी ए बोली ए मेरम मेरी उस सर दी मुस्कान दी दुखी जुगा दी आंदी की ये आसे ने टकरां दी तर माता पाते दा मानू सोची सोची टुरदा दिल चलदा पर उफ नहीं करदा बिच्चो बिच्चे कुरदा गामा पा गामा रे सारे नी पानी सागा रे पारे गागा रे सा पासा रे सा पारे गा रे सा गामा पा गामा रे सारे नी पानी सागा रे पारे गागा रे सा पासा रे सा पारे गा रे सा
तुस पापा जी रोए होए दे
तुस पापा जी रोए होए दे आओ सकुला जन्नी पे अपनाओ सबक सदांदी भर के पन्ने पन्ने पी के मादा नुस्खा लिए गल ऊपरी पुछ दी
कैसी तुस कुंदे ने दसो आऊं जरा नहीं रुसदी
ए वे दे दी अमर निशानी इन्नी सेवा कर दी
मेरे खोरे बोलेगी मन मारी बेचरती किया आँखा खोई नहीं सकते इरखी बोल जबानी सीने दे बिच हिरदे चलदा नैने अंतर पानी
Great. Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen, for joining us. This was a very illuminating session, and I will see you. We'll see more, hopefully, seeing all of you next year as well. And thank you for all your love, all your encouragement, and all your and granting us that drive to go ahead with our cause. Thank you so much, and good night.
Pa 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 ga pa 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 da da ma ma ma.